Well, thank you very much for the introduction, and many thanks to the Parliamentary Library for extending the invitation to me to talk today. So yeah, that abstract was a bit dense. I wrote it while I was in Myanmar, and I was putting it together quite quickly. But what I will be doing today is speaking about, you know, this general trend towards. People talk about rising populism. People talk about the strengthening of authoritarianism. We have issues like impeachment in the US. We have prorogation of parliament in the UK. We have the recent October elections in Poland that brought back this very problematic government back into power. We have issues in Venezuela and so on and so on and so on. I was watching last night, I'm not sure if any of you are watching it. It's a new British series called Years and Years. And each episode, they start at the present day, and each episode jumps forward by a few years, and everything just gets worse and worse and worse over time. And sometimes when you're talking about this issue, that seems to be the narrative, that things are only going to get worse. And that certainly used to be how I would present it, because I would be anatomizing what's going wrong. But I think we also have to link up with the possibilities of democratic renewal. Are there signs of hope? Are there green shoots? So today I really just want to talk about, you know, an overview of what we're talking about when we talk about global democratic decay. I want to provide a sense of the different kinds of decay that we're worried about in different states and the trends involved. And because I don't want to be too pessimistic, I'll talk about whether the picture contains any signs of hope. And if I have some time at the end, I'll say a few quick words about a global online information hub that I launched in 2018. It's called Democratic Decay and Renewal. So before I dive in to the actual substance, I should say three things. The first thing is that I don't approach this from a partisan perspective. So, you know, it's obvious that direct threats to democracy come from all sides of the political spectrum. We have everything from far-right government in Hungary to the socialist dictatorship under Maduro in Venezuela. So it's important to make that point. And the wider trends, whether it's polarization or technology or what have you, are issues that concern all parties, regardless of their place on the political spectrum, unless you get out to the very extremes. Second is that I won't be saying a whole lot about Australia itself, but I am going to stick to a sort of general global overview in this talk. And anything I do say about Australia, I should say, comes from, as you can hear from my accent, an Irish immigrant who has a deep affection for Australia and, you know, real regard for Australia's democratic system. And the third thing is really to highlight that this subject is one that's very close to my heart. I don't approach this as a dry academic issue to be sort of pored over as a puzzle. So I've been up close and personal with a lot of the issues in various countries around the world. My first exposure to it was actually while I was representing the Irish Supreme Court in the Council of Europe, and seeing up close what was happening in Hungary when the Fidesz government came to power in 2010. And I left the court in 2011, but I've stayed in touch with the Council of Europe since then. You know, I was in Brazil in 2013 doing research when the democratic crisis started to really come into effect. And this is long before Bolsonaro, and I'll be maybe saying something about that. I was managing a Council of Europe project in Turkey after the attempted coup d'etat in 2016, and right as Erdogan started to go into full-on dictator mode. And I've been traveling the world for years basically looking at this up front. And, you know, I was on a speaking tour of the US earlier this year. I've been in Europe multiple times. I was in Delhi in August, the School of Government at University of Melbourne, which I'm assistant director of, held a really interesting forum on the future of electoral democracy in Australia and India. So, you know, I've seen this from many angles, and I've seen the human cost of what we're talking about. You know, so I've seen, you know, judges and academics that I know being intimidated by the government, being kicked out of their jobs, being trolled. I've seen friends having to leave the country because of being vocal opponents of governments that are pushing a slide towards something closer to authoritarian rule rather than democratic rule. So I'm just going to give a quick overview of first of what we mean by democratic decay, and first you have to know what's decaying. So generally across academia and policy these days, we tend to talk about liberal democracy as containing three main elements. So of course we have full, free and fair elections, but that's not enough. It's absolutely essential, but that's not enough. So we also have to talk about, are there meaningful checks on government that keep government limited and keep government accountable? So those can be parliamentary opposition, independent courts, the independent civil service, civil society organizations, and so on. And then rights. You have to have at least core protection of core democratic rights, rights of free speech, rights of freedom of assembly and association, but also minority rights. A lot of people would highlight that you can't call yourself a real liberal democracy if minority rights are not protected. So that's just a general definition. And what we, by democratic decay, we're talking about a sort of deterioration of a liberal democratic system that happens step by step rather than being ended by a quick blow, like a military coup d'etat or an invasion. So some people would call this death by a thousand cuts. You just keep on chipping away at the democratic system until there's it's been completely changed. Others use the boiling frog analogy. So this is the idea that, you know, a frog in a pan of slowly boiling water doesn't jump out because it doesn't realize the danger that it's in until it's too late. And so this kind of threat to democracy has become the dominant threat to democracy, according to many analysts, in recent years. So if you look at the graph here, people have started to, one US scholar in particular has started to talk about this as a global democratic recession that's every bit as dangerous or more dangerous than the global financial crisis, for example. So for decades, and especially since the 70s, you had this sort of global expansion of democracy. Democracy was getting better where it already was, and authoritarian regimes were switching to democracy, dictatorships being flipped over. And it was to the point that while not every state was democratic, people started to assume that the future was democratic, the world's future was democratic. But in the mid-2000s, we start to see this decades-long trend stall and then reverse. So you have, you know, every major democracy assessment organization since the mid-2000s has started to register declines across the world, and that's been the case for over a decade. So we weren't prepared for this. You know, we assumed that democracy was going to continue expanding, so policymakers and academics have been scrambling to understand a phenomenon that's rolling out in front of our eyes and that has many different features, and that has upended a lot of our assumptions. So initially, sort of this trend was seen in isolated states like Venezuela. But it's really once you hit 2010 that it starts to become much more obvious. You have the government coming to power in Hungary. You see places, younger democracies like Poland starting to get into trouble, but it's not really until it becomes more obvious in long-established democracies, especially the USA with the election of Donald Trump, that the world's attention really, really started to fix on this as a problem. So I'll be saying a little bit about various countries, but you can see a number of key states here that I've put on the map. But it can be, I'll be saying something about all of these states, or virtually all of them, but it's hard to get a handle on what's happening worldwide because what it looks like different things are happening in different states. So what's useful is to start rolling out a few useful distinctions and rules of thumb or ways of understanding the differences among states. So three key distinctions here. One is that when we're talking about this global democratic recession, so Larry Diamond in the US tends to view it as four categories. So you have a deepening of authoritarianism in places that are already not democratic. You have an acceleration in the breakdown of democratic regimes, but we're more focused when we're talking about democratic decay on the third and fourth category. So that's a decline in the quality of democracy in both younger democracies and long-established democracies. So two additional distinctions here. One is that in some states, especially in younger democracies, what tends to happen is a master plan rolled out by a democratically elected government that is systematic and that's that hollows out the democratic system, and I'll be saying a little bit more about that. But on the other side, in many other states, you may not have that master plan, but you have a more diffuse deterioration of the democratic system. The third distinction is between younger democracies that have recently experienced authoritarianism. It might be 20 years ago, 25 years ago, 30, 40 even, if you think about Spain, and then longer established democracies that have never experienced full-blown dictatorship like the USA, or which have experienced it a lot much longer time ago, whether it's Germany or Japan or otherwise. So first, let's look at sort of master plan. So the central model for a master plan sort of hollowing out of democracy is Hungary. So I always think of the first time I presented on Hungary was back in November 2012. And the new government that had come in 2010 had introduced a new constitution. They had rolled out a number of laws that seemed to be giving the government more power over the media, more power over the courts. And you know, I laid this all out for the audience as best I could, and afterwards during Q&A, they were totally unconvinced, just totally unconvinced. You know, they thought there couldn't possibly be a problem. There had to be some sort of explanation for these laws. The constitution looked fine if you squinted and sort of took it as a whole, didn't look too close. And overall, there was a general sense that democracy couldn't possibly be rolled back in an EU member state. It just was outside of their reckoning. But today, you know, that's 7 years ago, and it's almost a decade since that government came into power. According to many assessment organizations and analysts, Hungary is no longer a liberal democracy. It's a hybrid regime that blends elements of democratic rule, like elections, with elements of authoritarian rule, like excessive concentration of power in the ruling party. Right, so how did they do this? You know, it was considered unthinkable. So how did they get from there to here? So it did this mainly through attacks on the structures of democracy. So the institutions that underpin democracy, keep the government accountable, and so on. So independent courts, prosecutors, the civil service, free media, and civil society organizations were all brought to heel by varying measures, often through the law, but also through abusive prosecutions, for example, changing the leadership of these organizations, and so on, court packing. There's many different ways. But it also changed the election law to make it much harder to vote the government out of power. So, you know, there's been a lot of gerrymandering in Hungary, which just allows the government to get a majority with fewer seats, fewer votes. And none of these were full frontal attacks. So there was no point where the government made it clear, we're in the middle of our master plan, you know, phase two is complete. Attacks on the judiciary were presented as judicial reforms, necessary judicial reforms. There was no closing down of newspapers or independent media or online media. You had independent buyouts of the media outlets by economic cronies of the government. So what you get is sort of, there's no one moment that galvanizes action where it becomes absolutely clear what's going on. And where anybody powerful, whether it's people with remaining within government or the public, external actors like the EU, say, this has to stop. We have to do something about this. And so, you know, 10 years later, almost, we're still at that phase. You know, a lot of actors, even the EU, are still waiting for that moment as though they're expecting for tanks to roll down the street. They're just not. But the whole system has changed. So the likes of Poland and Venezuela would be broadly within this master plan camp. Now, it doesn't roll out in exactly the same way, but the sequencing tends to be the same. You go for the courts first, then you go for the prosecution, and then finally you start changing the election laws because there's no court there to stop you, right? But in, you know, in Poland, for example, there are always differences in Poland. They didn't have the majority to change the constitution, so they've just rolled out just an endless raft of ordinary legislation to change the system. So that's sort of the master plan. And this hasn't been done by sort of overtly anti-democratic parties in these states. These parties present themselves as Democrats. They might present themselves as not being huge fans of liberalism. You know, in Venezuela, they'll say we're post-liberal. In Hungary, they'll say we're illiberal. But they will all claim to be Democrats. But it's not all about the master plan. And even where you have a master plan, there's usually a broader rot happening within the system. So I'll go through a few quickly. So one is the way that sort of the norms and the understandings that underpin democracy can be undermined by political actors. So you have, for example, the declining willingness of political actors to play by the rules of the game and according to established conventions. You have a rise in hyper-partisanship and a view that the political opposition is illegitimate, not just your political opponent, but illegitimate. A decline in shared principles of political discourse and democratic values, so values like civility. And you have characterizing certain communities, especially minority communities, as enemies of the true people. And the true people are the only people who you're governing for. We also have these wider and deeper tectonic shifts that Danny mentioned in his introduction, taking place in democratic systems worldwide. They're bringing these kinds of master plan governments to power, but also where there's no such government, they threaten the endurance of meaningful democratic government. So you have, you know, a crisis of representation with declining party membership, for example, and citizen connection to government in general. You have a fading public faith in democratic institutions in general and in democracy as a system of government. You have what's been called cultural backlash against rapid social, moral, and demographic change. You have rising economic inequality, and you have the profound and often negative effects of technology on society and the political system. So, you know, spreading disinformation, creating political echo chambers, making it very difficult for citizens to actually be the informed electorate that we require for democratic government. We also have more broadly, you know, the rise of authoritarian or non-liberal government models, the likes of China, Singapore, and so on, which are competing with liberal democracy or seen as competing. And then you have active external interference through election hacking and other subtler forms of influence. So you have all of that, even if you don't have a master plan government in place. So if we take the USA as an example very quickly, you know, we see a mixed picture. You know, you do see attacks on the structures of government. You know, at the state level, you have extreme gerrymandering, you have voter suppression, you see attacks on institutions at the federal level, but despite all the headlines that have been generated by the Trump administration, it hasn't achieved anything equivalent to what has been happening in Poland and Hungary, for example. You know, state institutions have not been captured to that extent. So the attacks have been really on the legitimacy of many institutions, not on their internal functioning or on their leadership. So in the USA, for many people, and you know, we can argue about this, but the threat is often viewed as on the substance of democracy side, not so much on the institutions themselves, but you know, we see this in extreme political polarization, no attempt to find political compromise, polls showing that less than 20% of the public believe their vote matters. Polls showing a rising number of people, significant proportions of the population, accepting the possibility of military government. And you have attacks, both rhetorical and physical, on minorities rising. Other people will say, you know, India would fall into that camp possibly, or a midway between master plan and diffuse. So a recent article, for example, in the Journal of Democracy just last week came out, and it suggests that you have, you know, very robust, vibrant electoral democracy in India. You've the highest turnouts in the last two elections that have ever been seen. But according to some analysts, the Modi government has diminished the capacity of the opposition to maneuver in parliament, has diminished constitutionally anchored minority rights, freedoms of expression, association, religious practice, putting political pressure on judges. And that is seen as highly problematic, as you can imagine. But the research on India is still sort of in its infancy, so it is still very contested. Going back to our map very quickly, you know, Japan, press freedom has plummeted in the last decade, but nobody's really talking about it. In the UK, is what's happening with prorogation of parliament and everything else, attacks on judges, is it all just connected to Brexit, or is it part of a wider sort of rot? South Africa, you know, we had a lot of attacks, rhetorical attacks in particular, on state institutions under Zuma, and now there's a sense of a restabilization, but people see wider dissatisfaction with the democratic system as continuing. So we have all these issues. But that's the depressing part. Right, that's where you roll out all of this and it seems like democracy is going backwards everywhere. I just want to say a few things about democratic renewal. So, you know, often the reaction to the idea of global democratic decay is complacency on the one hand and alarmism on the other. And really what I try to do and what I try to bring people together to do is focus on the evidence. What does the evidence tell us? And the evidence tells us often, be worried, be very, very worried. But it also tells us there are other signs of hope that we should hold on to. And there are ways of looking at this that aren't so despairing. So I'm going to talk about a few quickly. So even where authoritarians have entrenched themselves in power in places like Poland and Hungary and Turkey and so on, there is pushback. So you have, for example, in Hungary and Turkey recently, recent local elections, the ruling party has lost the capital city, big blow, and that's despite, you know, all the gerrymandering and massive statewide propaganda campaigns. In Poland, in the elections, the general election a few weeks ago, despite taking over the public media and a huge propaganda campaign, the government did not even increase its share of MPs and lost the Senate. So you have this sort of electoral pushback. In places like Brazil, attempts to carry out authoritarian policies have been unexpectedly very strongly resisted by Congress, by the media, and by the public. And in many states, authoritarian-leaning governments have simply shown themselves to be inept. In Austria, for example. People like Wojciech Sidorski, who's a Polish scholar based in Sydney, will say that authoritarian governments contain the seeds of their own destruction. They don't have anything to offer the people. They have lies, they have a certain way of viewing the world, but they often tend not to be very good on policy. So moving to awakening, we can say beyond pushback across democracies worldwide, the crisis of global democracy has awakened Democrats to out of their complacency, out of sleepwalking into disaster. And we can say certain assumptions that we've had are slowly being cast aside. One really important one is that democracy once entrenched is very hard to roll back. We now know it's not that hard to roll back. Another is a faith that technology is going to lead to improvement in our lives and in our societies and political systems, that absolutely is being thrown out the window now. So those are useful changes. And I think we might be seeing the end of the complacency, the post-1989 complacency that we've been living with for 30 years. We also have the enduring power of the democratic idea, the allure of it. You know, some people will tell you liberal democracy is dead as an idea. It has lost its force. It has lost its vitality. Simply not true. You know, if you look at transitions and protests around the world, people still believe in democratic freedom. You know, you look at Hong Kong, you look at the transition in the Gambia, you look at the reform in Ethiopia, and people still believe in this as an idea. Innovation, very quickly. So for many democracy analysts, it's not enough to push back, to try and get back what we had before the trouble was seen as having started. And it's not enough to just turn the clock back. So as they see it, to protect democracy, we have to remake democracy. And one of the key innovations here that is really mushrooming around the world is the idea of citizens' assemblies as another way of giving citizens a way of connecting with the political system and affecting policy. So we have, you know, you convene a mini public that's representative of the wider society to discuss particular issues. And recent research does show that they can be effective in cutting across hyperpolarized political climates, that you can get a greater diversity of voices, and you can get a greater weight to expert opinion or due weight to expert opinion without expertise taking over or technocracy taking over. And some see them actually as an alternative to populism because they take the dissatisfaction of citizens with liberal democracy seriously, but give that dissatisfaction a channel to go to, you know, in terms of positive reform and engagement. So we see these experiments have been rolling out, especially in the past year. In France, we had in Ireland, very what are seen as successful bodies like the Citizens' Assembly. In the UK, there's plans for a range of these assemblies. And in Belgium, in February, we saw the establishment of the first ever permanent citizen council, which is equal to Parliament, and which is going to set the agenda and monitor follow-up by Parliament of the recommendations from a variety of citizens' assemblies. So this is really happening right now. And you know, because it's only being rolled out, we have to really see how successful these are going to be. So the final thing to talk about is leadership. And I always think it's one of my favorite Australian phrases is teaching somebody how to suck eggs. I think it's funny. I don't want to say too much about leadership in Parliament because, you know, I'm speaking to leaders. But it is very obvious, no matter how successful certain democratic innovations might be, political leadership is going to remain, you know, absolutely essential to a fully functioning democracy. So that just means not just the ability to envision a better future and persuade people to come with you, but on the negative side, you know, it means exercising the discipline to put long-term public good and public interest above immediate partisan advantage and immediate partisan interest. So that's sort of where we can think about signs of hope, signs of renewal, where we might go. I'll use my final minute, if I have a minute, just to very quickly say, in my work across academia, government, international organizations, one thing that's happened again and again is people come to me and say, if they're in academia, I don't know how to get my research, whether it's on Hungary or Poland or US, to a policy audience. Policy people will say to me, I don't know who's working on this at the academic side, who has the expertise. People often don't know who's working on the same issues in another country or another world region. So I set up this online information hub as a way of connecting people and creating a community of scholars and policymakers to learn from one another, but they can also feed information into the hub. So this has become a sort of victim of its own success. I was telling John, it's like a full-time job of its own. But it contains seven key sections. So we produce a monthly global research update, which gives people a sort of an overview of what's been produced in the past month. And it's a way of being sort of the world's research assistant. A lot of the people, especially in states being affected the worst by democratic decay, are starved of resources. And this is a way to help them and connect them with others. We have a concept index so people can come to it and understand what are the main terms being used and how do people talk about these issues across boundaries. So often the same issue is discussed under 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 different terms. We have an experts database so people can see who else is working here and people can put themselves forward as an expert. We have an events database which is self-explanatory. We have teaching material, so I've taught on this in the university and there's also a space for others to upload their course material. So if you want to teach your students about this, you know, educate the next generation of democracy defenders, you can draw from these. You know, once again, it's about helping people move forward. We do some isolated campaigns here and there with different partners. One was a campaign for the European Parliament vote on Hungary, whether they were going to initiate the treaty process to sanction it for violation of rule of law and democracy. And we sent to all members of the European Parliament 10 key quotes from Viktor Orban in Hungary, which show that he's absolutely anti-democracy. And that was very helpful. I mean, we can't claim that it was us who got that yes vote, but those are the kinds of areas where we try to help. And finally, we have a resources database. It's a links section, effectively, but it lists all kinds of research projects, resources, online resources, organizations working in this area. So it really is, once again, a hub attempting to provide in one place what is just scattered everywhere otherwise. So thank you for listening to me. I'm really interested in Q&A, and yeah.
Thanks, Tom. That's right.